morning. Good morning. Come on. Don't make me sing up in here. Oh, now it's getting quiet now. Okay. Yeah, y'all don't want me to sing. I hear the chains falling. I'm done. I can't do it. Good morning, y'all. It's so good to see you this morning here at Gateway Church. I'm Pastor Donnell, and I am excited to see y'all this morning. I think I'm getting used to being out here in Louisiana because now I keep saying y'all all the time. All the time. I was doing a video for our social media page, and I had to redo it like 10 times because I kept saying, and y'all just come, and y'all just see. I'm an English major. Anyway, it's just like, well, it's so good to see you this morning. If this is your first time joining us here at Gateway, we would love to connect with you. So right in front of your seats, we have something called Connect Cards. I didn't bring one up here, but you'll see it. It's a blue card, and it's right in front of your seat. If you would fill one of those out, it'd be awesome. Pastor Dusty and Chantal would love to greet you and meet you right out in the foyer after service. And as always, something that we say all the time, if you are new or your second time or your third time or you want to get familiar with who we are, we love to say our evangelistic phrase, which is, sing it. Oh, my goodness. You guys are still on that. I think I've retired from that. Is who is not here that should be, and who do you plan to invite? I'm sorry. I was looking at Mr. Steve Lindsay. I thought he was, do it. Who is not here that should be, and who do you plan to invite? Well, just a few announcements before we get started is that we still have our deacon nominations are still going on. So the ballot, it's in the foyer still. The ballot are still in the foyer, and so please make sure you submit your nominations throughout this month. It's Easter. I keep saying Easter. Thanksgiving. I don't want to jump the gun, but Thanksgiving is next week, so I pray you guys have some pretty awesome plans for next week, right? Food, turkey, ham? No, none of you? Okay, great. Deacon nominations right in the foyer. Also, we still want to invite you guys to our Facebook page. If you have not joined our Facebook page in our group, Sharing Life at Gateway. And here you can see all our updates. You can see it's just another way of connecting with our body. And so it'd be awesome. Just go on Facebook on your page. Look up Sharing Life at Gateway and click to join. And we make sure you get in there. Also, there is a baby shower happening on December 2nd at 3 p.m. And all invited. And the baby shower is going to be for Becky Kendrick. Is Becky Kendrick in here? Where's Becky Kendrick? Can you stand up so you guys can see who Becky Kendrick is? That's Becky Kendrick right there. So she is having a baby shower on December 2nd at 3 p.m. All you guys are invited. So, yeah, it's going to be awesome. Well, at this time, we're going to invite Mr. Tommy King. Where's Mr. Tommy King at? Tommy King. There he is. That's the man right there. Look at that walk. Man, you guys have some smooth walks, man. I'm telling you. That's a bad man right there. There you are.
Unlike Donnell, I am not an English major. And there is nothing wrong in Louisiana with saying y'all. But as most of the board members, or deacons, if you will, at Gateway Church, we all have what we identify as a portfolio, and that's something that's just an area of responsibility. My area of responsibility for a while now has been this facility, which we've been so richly blessed with. And it's just amazing how God has allowed and blessed Gateway Church with the facility that we have. This facility that we're sitting in and the foyer, or the corridor, I'm sorry, is 14 years old. And the other facility, the Family Life Center and the other parts of the church are probably, the dates escape me, but it's probably around 30, maybe a little over 30 years. So with that being said, I think we all realize and understand that there's upkeep and responsibility that's required. And our staff and the board and a lot of you have done an absolutely amazing job, especially in 2016, 17, and 18. And I'll just briefly mention some of the things that we've accomplished is there were some ladies that got together and redid the ladies' bathroom back in the Family Life Center, which is absolutely amazing. I wouldn't suggest all of you go look at it, but there could be an opportunity where some of you ladies may be able to look at it, but they did an awesome job. And they just volunteered for that and got the materials. Another thing is that our pastor and the staff, along with the board, we've got 38 thermostats throughout this facility. We transitioned over to Wi-Fi thermostats, which is a savings in how your air conditioner units run and your heating units. So we've got 26 of them replaced, so we still need to replace some this year. We've had some air conditioners and heating units that we've had to replace. And everything that we're doing is we're working very diligently in trying to save energy, which everybody knows that's a very costly commodity, as well as LED lighting in the sanctuary and other parts of the church, which is a cost savings as well. But everything that we have to do and everything that we look at to try to accomplish costs money. And I'm not going to ask for an offering. But I will ask for at some point in time for you to have the opportunity to give your talents and your gifts. Shirley can tell you that I am not a handyman. And there's probably a lot of us in here that may not be handymen, but there's a lot of us in here that's got some tremendous gifts. And I think that that we can all come together. There'll be opportunity in the weeks and the months to come for you to display those gifts in whatever ministry you choose to participate in. But regardless, we are so very grateful and so very thankful for the people at Gateway Church and what you do and the pride you take, which we all should. This is God's house. It doesn't belong to any of us as individuals, but God requires us to maintain his house is the very best that we can. And I appreciate everything you guys do. God bless you.
I thought he was going to get up here and tell you that his job is to keep me in line. Just a village?
Yes.
Man, y'all, I'm excited about what Jesus is doing, right? Not just what he's about to do, because he's already doing it. Amen? Amen. So we're going to receive our tithes and our offering this morning. You may have noticed that we have Teen Challenge in the house this morning, and so very excited about that. Y'all know I'm a Teen Challenge graduate, so I love Teen Challenge. So, amen. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Teen Challenge. But we'll talk more about that in a little bit. And we will take up an offering at the end of service for them. So this is just your tithes and your offering this morning. But one of the things that we've been talking to you about is our new giving platform. You'll see up there on the screen what I decided to do. I pay my tithes online. So I thought, you know, I'll just show you how fast you can pay your tithes online with our new giving solution there at PushPay. So I'm going to go ahead. You can put that up there. So if you want to tithe online, you can text the number 77977. A lot of sevens for that perfect Jesus stuff. You know what I'm saying? Good stuff right there. 77977. And then you just text our little hashtag, GW Shreve. And it's going to give you a link. You click the link and it'll set you up. Once you get it set up, you can go ahead and give your tithes online that way. And so while I'm doing it, I'm just showing you right here what you do. So when you pull it up on your phone, you just tell it how much you want to give. You can click where you want to give it to, and then how often you want to give it, and you can give, and it's done. I just paid my tithes. How about that? 10 seconds, you can pay your tithes online. Look, we've done that because so many of you talk about you don't carry checks anymore. You know, you don't carry cash. I never have checks, and I never have cash. So we wanted to present a way to you to help do that. So we always do that. But the thing that we always remind you about your giving, remember, you may be entrusting a church with your gift, but you see it as giving unto Jesus, right? You serve because you're serving Jesus, right? You give because you give to Jesus. You worship because you worship Jesus, right? You're here this morning because of Jesus. I know there's a lot of good people, and you love the fellowship, and you love to sing the songs, but it's got to be about Jesus, right? It's got to be about Jesus. We want our heart to always be in that right place. So, hey, before we give this morning, we want to pray for you. Maybe you have a need, a financial need. Maybe you have a need in your family. Maybe you just have some stuff going on at your work. You need God to intervene. We just ask that you stand. You're going to see people standing all over the sanctuary. Why are we doing this? Because we're standing in faith, believing God is a God who answers prayers. Amen? And he does. He answers prayers all the time. So stand and ask God to meet those needs. I'll pray for you, pray over your needs and the tithes and the offering. Jesus, this morning, as we stand before you, you've seen the need. You know the need before we ever even ask. In fact, Psalm 139 says, you know when we sit and when we stand. You know our thoughts, even when they're far away. God, you know those things about us. God, those that are praying for loved ones that have wandered away from the faith. God, those that have issues in their workplace. God, over marriages, I'm praying that you'd bring reconciliation, that you'd bring healing, Jesus. Over those that are just needing you to intervene on their behalf with their finances, their workplace, whatever it may be this morning, Jesus. We need you. God, you're our hope. You're our answer. And so today we're trusting in you. Even as it is with our tithes and our offering, God, we believe you this morning to provide for Gateway Church. God, that we can meet the facility needs that we have. That, God, we continue to reach more souls. So I pray that you'd bless the giver. Those that are unable to give this morning, I pray that you'd help them to get to a place where they take that step of faith and be obedient to you. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen. Well, as the ushers are coming around to receive the tithes and the offering, maybe you didn't get it right. We also have giving boxes at the back. You can put your gift in there as well. But just a couple announcements. In your bulletin, you may have saw we have a directory update in there. And if you didn't get one of these, could you just raise your hand and maybe we can help get you some of these as well. The goal of this is we want to stay connected, and something we still do around here is we have a church directory. All the time you're trying to get a hold of people and you don't know how to get a hold of them. And so we're doing two things with this. One, we want to make sure we have all the correct information in our directory. Sometimes addresses change, sometimes phone numbers change. And so we want to get the correct information in there. And two, we want to make it available to those that want it to be available. So you can check on there, one, don't publish my information. Or if you want it to be published, you can check that as well. But please fill this out so we can at least get an updated, your information. And you can put those in the giving boxes as well. So you can do that at the back. You could do that there this morning. And then finally, before we invite Teen Challenge, if you guys want to go ahead and start getting in place, you can do that. Or if you're going to say something before they come, that's as well. Last thing, next Sunday, Pastor Chantal and I are going to begin a new series entitled Family Matters. You know, we believe that Christmas is a time where families come together. They get to reminisce. They get to think about the future and just quality time together. But you know what? If you're like me, sometimes families have issues, right? We got issues. I got a lot of issues. I know that's why it takes a village to help me, Pastor Andy. I'm telling you, I got a lot of issues. Y'all think you got issues. I'm telling you, I got issues. But anyways, we're going to start a series on families. And so we want you to be out and involved and engaged on that. So just looking forward to that. Would you welcome Andy Jenkins as he tells us about Teen Challenge?
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. We greatly appreciate y'all. You can leave it there, I guess. That's fine. You can do whatever you want, Pastor. Thank y'all for having us. We greatly appreciate it. I know Pastor loves Teen Challenge, him being a graduate of it. I was a graduate of it. I graduated in 1992. I'm kind of a hometown boy. I grew up in Mansfield. I remember when the church was built over here years ago. So anyway, my name's Andy Jenkins. My wife, Christy, and I are the directors of Minden Teen Challenge, and I'm here this morning representing Louisiana Adult and Teen Challenge. And for those of you that may not know what we are, we're a discipleship program that helps people who are struggling with life-controlling addictions. I heard a statistic the other day that kind of blew my mind. If you drive down any street in America, just any street in America, every third house you pass by, someone in that household is struggling with an addiction. It kind of puts things in perspective. And but here's the thing. There's an answer. Amen? And it's not multiple answers. It's just one answer. Amen? Because drugs and alcohol is not the problem. That is symptoms of the problem. The real problem is sin. And there's only one cure for sin, and there is a cure. It's Jesus. Amen? And so we're just simply a discipleship ministry trying to help people find Jesus and teach them how to live out biblical Christianity. That's all we are. We're a little bit like a Bible college, a little bit like a boot camp, and a little bit like a family. And so they come to us, and they're with us for 18 months, and we just disciple them and help them understand the scriptures and help them to deal with some of the issues that they never dealt with in a biblical way. Amen? And so we're just an extension of the church. We're here to promote Jesus, but we're also here to help you know that there is help for your loved one, because I promise you, in this room right now, at this moment, there are people that know people. Maybe it's a son or a daughter or niece or nephew, aunt, uncle, cousin, somebody. You know somebody struggling with an addiction. Well, we're here to help. Amen? So we want you to feel like we're an extension of your church. We're here to help you, Pastor. Amen? And we want to see lives change. So I'm going to quit rambling. In just a moment, you're going to hear some of these ladies and gentlemen share testimonies and sing songs. When they come into the choir, when they come into Teen Challenge, they're automatically in the choir. Pastor Dusty, was that the same way? Yeah, that's right. You were in the choir. Whether you wanted to be in the choir or not, you were in the choir. And so in just a moment, they're going to come and they'll share testimonies. But if you'll turn your attention to the screen, we have a brief video we'd like to show you. And let's welcome them as they come. Amen.
But I was unable to stop my addiction, and that resulted in my mother getting custody of him. After that, I didn't care anymore. I just wanted to die. I always hoped for an overdose. Last year, on Mother's Day 2017, I took a pistol to kill myself. I was stopped from pulling the trigger. 2 weeks later, I found out that I was pregnant and had been pregnant when I tried to kill myself. This really shook me up, and I knew that I couldn't bear to lose another child. So I turned myself into jail for a capias to get clean, and I was able to remain clean throughout my pregnancy. But at 6 months, I was indicted for two charges of selling drugs that had been dated the year prior. So my past had caught up with me. In jail, I cried out to God. I begged him not to let me be separated from my baby. I told him that I would go anywhere he wanted and I would do anything he wanted. I just completely surrendered to him. 2 days later, a lady came in to do a jail ministry, and she had an application for the Mendon Family Center with my name on it. I knew that God sent this to me. I filled it out. I got out of jail to have my baby, and when she was 3 weeks old, her and I got on a plane, and we flew to Louisiana. Arriving at Teen Challenge was the beginning to the end of my suffering. God healed me, and he delivered me from addiction. He delivered me from guilt, and if that's all that he did for me, it would have been enough. But he continues to restore me, and he continues to bless me. God has softened my family's hearts, and they receive me with forgiveness. My children came to visit me last month. That was the first time that I had seen them in 3 years, and they met their baby sister. Teen Challenge is my refuge. It's where God has brought me to heal me and to mold me. I'm learning to listen to him and to be led by his spirit, which is all I'm ever going to need in life. I don't know what God has planned for me, but I know it's going to be great, and I'm excited about my life. There's a real enemy out there, and he almost had me, and he had me bound up for 13 years in addiction and in torment, and God took me out of that suffering and out of that torment and out of that corruption, and he has given me everything that I need to live in victory. And that's why I stand on 2 Peter 1, 3, and 4. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises so that through them, we may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. And that's what God has done for me. He lets me participate in his divine nature. And the fact that God even allows me back into his family and into his kingdom after all I've done completely blows my mind. I will spend the rest of my life serving the Lord.
My name is Jeremiah Hall. I was born and raised in Keytesville, Louisiana. I have an older brother and a baby sister. My parents split up early in my life. Everyone in my family has had a broken relationship, so it didn't take long before I didn't trust anyone and always wanted for the next thing to fail in life. Nor did I care who I hurt in my life, especially the ones closest to me. Being raised in the country, Drinking was part of life. Before I can remember, I had drank beer with my uncle, and by the age of 9, trying liquor. At age 14, I was sneaking around drinking and smoking pot. Getting expelled in the 8th grade for drinking at a talent show, somehow still making it through school, graduating, and even attempting college. Didn't make it very far. I began using cocaine and ecstasy, which soon began to stealing and robbing cars. At 19, caught charges, and they were trying to give me 25 years for it. During court, I moved to Mississippi to get away and help my mama and her husband fight cancer. Within a year, they both passed away, and back home I came. On probation, getting violated and going back to jail, I had gotten a call from my dad telling me my papa I grew up next door to had cancer. I knew at this time I was losing my best friend. I got out in time to go stay with him his last few months until he passed away. Sadly, through all this time, instead of getting my act together, I gained a meth addiction, and it accumulated fast. Even on their deathbeds, I stole, I lied, I manipulated, and I hurt everyone, especially my own family. I got rid of things that could never be replaced and meant the world to the ones that I loved most, all because I loved my addiction more, the escape it gave me from it all. Wasn't long after I met a love I'd never had before that would change my life forever, my kid's mother. We hit it off fast, and wasn't long before we moved to Texas. And just a few months passed, we went through something I wish no one ever had to endure. Our 3-year-old son passed away in our arms in the hospital because of malpractice. What happened will never leave either of us. What made things real hard to understand, soon after we found out she is pregnant with my oldest son, Elijah, and 2 years later have my son, Isaiah. Now, physically, I've always been there, but emotionally, not so much, because I focused on drugs more. We split up 2 years ago and have gone back and forth a lot since then. Realizing I lost it all because I didn't lead my family the way a man and a father is supposed to, my life spiraled down fast. So I landed myself back in jail, having 4 felonies, being arrested 32 times in 11 years, being on 2 counts of probation, catching 9 new felony charges on 3 arrests, and facing 15 years in prison. Having to watch my kids cry through a glass asking why you can't come home with them and mommy, knowing deep down my life was over and I had failed my family yet again. However, what I thought and what God's plan was for me was not near the same. He opened up an opportunity for me that will forever change my life. On May 1st, 2018, I entered Wrestling Teen Challenge. And from that day, I have finally learned what love and joy is really about. I wake up with a smile every day. I am so thankful for what God is doing in my life. I never believed I could have the life I am being given now. Me and my family's relationship is being repaired, and they are proud of me. I am finally going to be the father that God has planned for me. I also have brothers behind me that will stand beside me even through my hardest days, that encourage me and build me up. I was blessed with the responsibility of building the crosses as a job. I don't even feel like I work because I love what I get to do. I know without a doubt that God has called me into ministry, and I will follow my call into whatever direction that God leads me to. I'm ready to see how God is going to work through me to make a difference in people's lives. He gave me a year to learn and study all about Him, and I'm taking full advantage of it. I never believed I would have a real purpose in life until He has shown me I am His child, I will prosper, and He has a purpose for my life. The verse I stand on is Jeremiah 39:18. I will save you. You will not fall by the sword, but escape with your life because you trust in me, declares the Lord.
Push, I pull, go back and forth, finding myself. Pounding on a locked door, I try to make it out alone without your help. But I know I'll never win this war. I can never be free without you. I can never be me without you. This is the sound of chains breaking, this is the beat of a heart changing, this is the song of a soul forgiven. This is my freedom hymn. Ooh. This is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn. Ooh. This is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn. I breathe the air of freedom in, knowing my life is better off in your hands. The past is gone, what's done is done. Now I'm alive, and I'm never gonna look back. I can never be free without you. I can never be me without you. This is the sound of chains breaking. This is the beat of a heart changing. This is the song of a soul forgiven. This is my freedom hymn. Ooh, this is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn. Ooh, this is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn.
Who the sun sets
free
is free indeed. Who the sun sets
free
is free indeed.
Well,
who the sun sets
free
is free.
Yeah.
I'm free. Oh,
this is the sound of chains breaking. This is the beat of a heart changing. This is the song of a soul forgiven. This is my freedom hymn. This is the sound of chains breaking. This is the beat of a heart changing. This is the song of a soul forgiven. This is my freedom hymn. Ooh, this is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn.
Ooh,
this is my freedom hymn. My freedom hymn.
Ooh. I'm Sarah, I'm 35 and I'm from Florida. Hi. I was raised by a mom who suffered from mental illness. She was a single mom on disability with three girls. She did her best to care for us, but because of the severity of her mental illness, I experienced a lot of emotional neglect and abuse throughout my childhood. Satan used these circumstances to begin lying to me from a very early age. By the age of 5, he had effectively deceived me into believing that I was inherently unlovable and worthless. This deception would be my reality for the next 30 years. When I entered adulthood, I was essentially a broken child in a woman's body. My vulnerability left me open to being taken advantage of by many people, especially men. I desperately sought the love that I lacked inside from men who played, used, and discarded me. Between the ages of 18 and 27, I was violated by men so often that I stopped keeping track. Every traumatic event substantiated my belief that no matter what I did, I would never be good enough to deserve love. I used drugs and alcohol to cope with the trauma and abuse. I started drinking heavily when I was 15 years old and experimenting with drugs at that time. By my early 20s, I was addicted to all kinds of prescription opiates and eventually to heroin. When I was 27, I met my younger son's father. I thought he was the love of my life, but throughout the course of our relationship, I was subjected to emotional, verbal, and psychological abuse. I stayed in this relationship for 8 years because I believed that I could help him and that things would get better, but really I stayed because deep down I believed that I deserved to be abused and that there wasn't anything better for me. Over the last year of our relationship, the abuse became increasingly physical and violent. I was once again using opiates to cope and dangerously strung out. I was haunted daily by the look of fear and sadness on my 4-year-old son's face because of what my lifestyle was exposing him to. I had become very depressed and had lost almost all hope that there was a better life for me. And I knew that if I didn't change something soon, that I was going to kill myself. So I started looking for residential treatment programs that accepted women with children. And within a couple weeks, I found the number for Adult and Teen Challenge Minden Family Center. Once I called them and went through the admission process, my son and I were accepted into the program in a little over a week. So we took a Greyhound bus to Louisiana, and on May 15, 2018, we came to Teen Challenge, and that's where my testimony really begins. When I first got to Teen Challenge, I quickly realized that addiction was the least of my problems. I was so damaged from the years of abuse that I was completely controlled by fear and anger. I hated authority, I did not trust the staff, I didn't trust God at all, and to be honest, I was very angry with God. I felt like it was God that rejected me, that he labeled me as an abomination and a victim, and then sent me out into the world to be tormented and abused. But God has shown me that that was a lie. Amen. Psalm 145 verse 9 says that God is good to everyone, that he showers compassion over all his creation. I am his creation who he showers with love and compassion. I came to God angry and full of rebellion against him, but because of his great and faithful love for me, he has gently led me to a place of trust and total submission to him. In that place, I've been able to open myself up to God so that he has reached deep inside of my heart and began to heal 35 years worth of emotional and spiritual wounds. He has blown every lie that Satan has ever told me about myself to pieces. Where I was once a weak, pathetic victim, he has made me a mighty warrior. Once unloved and overlooked, but now he calls me his precious princess. Once regarded as worthless trash, now I know that he has chosen me for his good works. I am no longer ruled by fear and anger, but free to have and enjoy my life. I am free to walk in joy and confidence as the woman he created me to be and who he says I am. Through his lies and schemes, Satan tried to drive me to suicide. And if he had succeeded, I would probably be in hell right now, and he would have my soul forever. He has kept me in bondage since my earliest memory, but now on this day I can say that I am free by the blood of Jesus Christ. I know that my God has redeemed me. He calls me his child, and he loves me and will never leave me. The verse I stand on is Isaiah 43, 1 and 2. But now, this is what you, the Lord, say, you who created me, you who formed me. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze.
You can see what God is doing in the ministry of Teen Challenge. Amen? We have rules and, we have a program, we have a structure, but that's not what changes their lives. It's God that changes their lives. And in just a moment, Pastor Dusty's going to come. He's going to give y'all an opportunity to make an investment in Teen Challenge. We are a program here in Louisiana, Teen Challenge. We don't charge a monthly fee for them to be with us. We don't bill insurances. We don't have, the government doesn't send us money every month. We don't have a great rich uncle that writes us a check every month to help. But we depend upon God and the work of our hands. So if you could do me a favor, how many of you have a cell phone? Get your cell phone out. How many of you got one of these? Get these out. How many of you got one of these brochures? Come on now. Don't make me come down there. No, I'm just kidding. Got this? Got a cell phone. There are, just like your church is giving you multiple ways to give, we have multiple ways to give. Little as much when God is in it. Amen? And we need help. We need your help. We need ongoing monthly support. We need people to help give on an ongoing monthly basis so that you can continue to see lives being transformed by the power of God. Amen? We are called to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Amen? And aren't you glad for missionaries that go to those faraway remote locations so you don't have to? Right? Amen? And aren't you thankful for a program like Teen Challenge that'll take in people and help disciple them? Amen? Right here in your community. So inside your brochure, there is an easy way to give. It's text to give. If you follow the instructions on screen or on this brochure right here, it'll tell you how to give. And it's $10 a month added to your cell phone bill. You get a prompt every month. I personally do this. One of the ways that I give back, I personally do this myself. I get a prompt every month that says, hey, you signed up for this. Do you still want to continue? And it's just an easy way to give, $10 a month right there, text to give. Also inside your brochure is this card here. It tells you how you could give on a monthly basis. And if you become a monthly partner with us after the service today, if you go out to either one of our tables and talk to the people at our table, you could receive a gift today if you become a monthly supporter. And I'm going to ask Pastor Dusty to come and help receive an offering for Teen Challenge today. Thank you so much. And they're still going to sing some songs and some more testimonies too.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You know, one of the ways if you want to show your pastor that you love him is support Teen Challenge. Because it's a testimony. If you like what God is doing here, it's because of Teen Challenge. I'm going to share a little bit about that here in just a little bit after they're done sharing some stories. But when you've done to the least of these, Jesus said you've done it under him. Amen? Right? And I could share a lot of things about that. But you're investing in world changers. You're investing in world. Teen Challenge produces world changers. They literally do. They produce world changers. Those that will stay in the program, those that will commit to the process, they become world changers. Right, because they'll stand up in the face of hell and say, I done been there. Yeah. Right, I done been there and done that. I got a few testimonies to talk about it, a few scars to prove it, right, both on your physical body and the other ones Jesus heals. So, he didn't. I still got some pretty good scars on my physical body, but he healed the scars on my heart. But no joke, seriously, your investment into this ministry is literally... let me say this before I say that. The spiritual warfare that is involved in ministries like Teen Challenge, like pregnancy centers, Teen Challenge is literally and pulling people out of the pits of hell and putting them on a rock, and they're testifying to the power of deliverance, and the devil don't like that. You may not believe it here this morning that the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I can tell you I believe it with all my heart because he came to do it to me. And I was in that place, and they've been in that place. And so you're partnering with a ministry that is silencing the enemy, that is taking back what the devil tried to steal from them, right? Right? We go right down up into his camp and take it back, right? Because I come in the name of Jesus, right? Like, I don't just try to hype you up when I say I speak the name of Jesus. I ain't got nothing else to speak, right? So, I'm just going to speak Jesus' name and watch him do what Jesus does. So I'm going to invite our ushers to come forward. If you make out your checks this morning, if you do checks, you can do that. And just write all of them to Gateway Church, and we're going to cut them one big check, right? One big check for that. You can also, if you're giving to church, you can do the same thing we said earlier. If you want to just do it through the church, you can also text 77977 and just mark in the other section. You can do that for Teen Challenge. And everything that comes in is going to go straight to the ministry of Teen Challenge. So would you pray with me over what God would do and continue to do? Are the testimonies not powerful? I've been trying to stop crying. A mom, she tapped me on the shoulder over there, and she pointed up and she said, that's my baby up there. And it just breaks my heart because I know what the enemy's been doing for years. But then it encourages my heart because I see what Jesus is doing. Right? I know what I put my mom through for years. I know what my brothers put my mom through. I know what my sisters put my mom through, right? And so the joy of seeing what God is doing. And you get a partner with that. Amen? Jesus, this morning over our offering that we give unto you to continue to keep this ministry pulling people out of the pits of hell, filling them with your spirit, filling them with the joy and peace that comes from knowing you. But God, the testimony of the living God that is rescuing and healing hearts, healing minds, Jesus, calling those into ministry. Jesus, this morning, our giving, I pray that it would just be exceedingly and abundantly above whatever we thought we were going to do. And Jesus, that we would give as unto you this morning to see this ministry continue to reach people. Holy Spirit, I pray your blessing upon this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I think they have some more testimonies, right, and more singing. Are you guys, a song? All right, I'm just going to let them do their thing.
In the same old road. How y'all doing this morning? My name's Justin Cobb. I'm 31 years old, and I'm from Lake Charles, Louisiana. Growing up, I had a pretty good childhood. My mom raised me and my little brother, and we moved around a lot with her trying to find work to support us. I went to 4 different elementary schools, and at a young age, I always felt the need to try to fit in. When I was 12 years old, my mom met my stepdad, who she is still with to this day, and we moved into his house. And with me being 12, I didn't agree or like this one bit, and already having issues with acceptance and rejection, I started to develop anger and bitterness. And I didn't know how to cope, so at the age of 14, I started to rebel, experimenting with alcohol and marijuana to run away from how I was feeling. I started to lie, steal, and cause all kinds of trouble at home. And at the age of 17, my mom and stepdad kicked me out. My drug use got worse. I started using prescription drugs and ended up moving to Houston, Texas with my grandmothers and uncles. I had used up all my friends and family in Lake Charles, and we all thought a change of location might help, but it didn't. Things only got worse. I started using cocaine and smoking PCP. And after doing this for a number of years and losing jobs and ruining my relationships in Houston, I moved back to Lake Charles. And this is where my life really took a downward spiral, and I was all in and was going wherever the drugs took me. At the age of 23, I was already in and out of jail on DUI and possession charges. And for the next couple of years, I ran away from my probation officer with warrants out for my arrest. This is when I was introduced to a needle, and I started to IV use meth. I lost track of time, going deeper and deeper into my addictions. I lost all sense of reality, not knowing what was real and what wasn't. I was living a complete lie, running from myself, causing a path of destruction everywhere I went. When I was 27 years old, my grandmother ended up moving to Lake Charles from Houston because she wasn't doing too good with her health, and she wanted to be closer to the family. And with the love she had for me and how she thought she could help me, she let me back into her life. And with me being in my addiction, I took total advantage of this. I manipulated her, I lied to her, I stole from her, and one night I ended up taking her vehicle across town to go get some drugs. And I never did make it back. I went on a 2 to 3 day binge, ended up nodding out at a red light, my foot came off the brake, and I rolled across the intersection, and a car hit me. And that night I went to jail for theft of a motor vehicle. I was at the lowest point in my life. Not only was I sitting in jail for stealing my grandmother's car, but no more than 2 months later, she passed away. And I went to her funeral in an orange jumpsuit and handcuffs. And for the first time in my life, I realized how far I let sin take me. I seen how horribly selfish I was. And with so much shame and guilt, I'd hit a breaking point and was finally fed up with who I had become. By the grace of God, drug court offered me Teen Challenge. And since coming to Teen Challenge, I see the truth now and have found a freedom and peace that I have never known. Instead of wanting to please myself and walk in rebellion, my heart desires to please God and walk in obedience. No longer am I seeing myself through the lenses of my past failures, and no longer am I letting my perception or my feelings steal the blessings of God's acceptance and approval of me. He knows my past, my present, and my future, and he still chooses me to be in relationship with him. I've been forgiven, redeemed, and set free by the blood of Jesus. And the scripture I stand on is 1 Peter 1:13. Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ.
These ladies are going to come, and they're going to do a drama. And then when that's over, Pastor Dusty, you can just come on up. You've seen and heard the gospel display today. And Jesus wants to continue to minister to everybody here. And we just want to come and lift up Jesus to you today, because people are struggling out there, and people need to know that there's a real legitimate answer. Amen? There's a real legitimate answer that people can be set free and delivered by the power of God. Amen? And these ladies are going to perform a drama, and then Pastor Dusty's going to come right after that. Thank you.
Behold, Jehovah, seated on the throne. Abba, Father, the well that overflows, the God who was and is and shall be
Before we come to a close, I'm going to ask the worship team to join me on the platform. But before we close, I want to encourage you this morning from God's Word. I want to share just a few things. There's a whole mix of people in this room this morning dealing with a whole mix of things. Amen? Psalm 77 is one that speaks so deeply to me, and I hope to share it so that you'll see how it can speak deeply to you. But the author writes, I cry out to God, yes, I shout. Oh, that God would listen to me. When I was in deep trouble, I searched for the Lord. All night long, I prayed with hands lifted toward heaven, but my soul was not comforted. Nothing was happening. I think of God and I moan, overwhelmed with longing for his help. You don't let me sleep. I'm too distressed even to pray. I think of the good old days long since ended when my nights were filled with joyful songs. I searched my soul and ponder the difference now. Has the Lord rejected me forever? Will he never again be kind to me? Is his unfailing love gone forever? Have his promises permanently failed? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he slammed the door on his compassion? And I said, this is my fate. This is it. The Most High has turned his hand against me. Come on, I bet you all felt that way. I bet you felt that way. You see, here's what I want you to hear this morning. Desperation leads to deliverance. Come on, desperate. When you get desperate, when you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, when you're finally really desperate and you feel like the night won't let up, it won't back up, it won't give you any room to breathe, and you've prayed and you've cried and your eyes hurt and your throat hurts and God still hasn't answered. You see, I want you to hear that. God ain't afraid of your pain. God ain't afraid of your fear. God ain't afraid for you to get to a place till it really gets desperate. Come on. He ain't afraid for Lazarus to lay in a grave for 4 days. He ain't afraid of it. He ain't afraid for it to get really, really bad, because he's the God that calls the things that are dead back to life. He called those things that do not exist as though they were. Because desperation, sometimes we're just not desperate enough. We're not willing to just go the as far as we gotta go. When I was sitting in that jail cell, and I'd been arrested for manufacturing methamphetamines, and I was the drug addict. I was using $700 a day of methamphetamines. I was manufacturing $5,000 to $15,000 worth of meth a week. I didn't sleep for days and days and days. I'd fall asleep here, fall asleep there. Come on. When I was in that place and I was sitting in that jail cell after they had just busted the door down and hauled me off to jail for the final time, because they'd already done this multiple times and multiple charges, and I'm looking at 40-some years in prison. The time previous to the busting into my door, they arrested me and I had a quarter of a kilo of methamphetamines in the front seat of the pickup. The time before that, it looked like an episode of the show of Cops. I'm running from the police. I'm driving through cornfields. I burn up my pickup truck. I'm running through the... It's just insane. I don't even know that person anymore. But, I mean, that's because Jesus... But how could it even be? Come on, I got to ask myself, are you telling the right story sometimes? Are you telling the right story? You sure this was you? I always keep the pictures of my burn-up pickup truck in my desk in case anybody don't believe me. No, I will tell you this, though. So I do have, I don't know, I was an athlete in school, and so my name was on the front page of the paper for a lot of things that I did in sports. But then the day that I burned down the barn from manufacturing meth, and then the day that I was arrested from running from the cops, you know what else was on the front page of the paper? You know, I got all of my highlights. I still got that little scrapbook. You know what I'm talking about, scrapbooks of, you know what I mean? Oh, yeah, he was an all-area catcher. Oh, yeah, he was batting 464. Oh, yeah, he did. So I got those in the back. I got that article. See, that article that said, you know, Dusty Small was just arrested for this. I put that in there because that's a real testimony. Remind me of what God has done for me, because I know of days when I said, all night long I prayed with my hands. Some of you moms have been praying all night long with your hands lifted toward heaven, and you felt like God wasn't there to comfort because it just kept happening, it just kept happening, and you just kept praying, and you felt like, God, do you even hear me? Do you even care? And when I was sitting there in that jail cell, I felt like the same thing. I was sitting at a metal desk looking at metal walls and bars and concrete blocks. And I thought, man, I've done it. I'm 27 years old. I'm going to go to prison for the rest of my life. They got all the evidence they need for me. I'm guilty. I'm going to spend the rest of my life in prison. I don't know Jesus. I wasn't raised in church. I wasn't calling out on God. I was getting high when I was in jail. That's what I was doing. They were sneaking dope in, and we were getting high in jail. I was hopeless. I didn't know Jesus. If I actually ever knew what it was like when Abraham said it, you know, that Paul wrote about Abraham, he said, against all hope, in hope he believed. You know, he was hopeless to have children. They were old. They couldn't have any kids. But there was a promise. And there was a man that came up, and he started to talk to me about Jesus. The guy in the cell block over told me about Teen Challenge, and I didn't know of Teen. We didn't know of Teen Challenge around us. I grew up in southern Indiana, and I went to Teen Challenge in West Virginia. I didn't even know what that was. But I called this guy to come up and tell me about it. Some of y'all, you've heard me tell this, but there's a lot of people here that ain't heard this. And this is a testimony. And so he started telling me about Jesus. And, you know, I thought that good people went to heaven. And you laugh, but I thought I was I thought I was a good drug dealer because I didn't cut my dope. And I gave people what it was, when it weighed, I didn't mess with my scales. Like, I thought I was a good dope dealer. And I remember being in Panama City Beach, and I can remember being on spring break and some people approaching me and asking me about, did you go to church? I'm like, yeah, I go to church. I'm high. You know what I'm saying? Like, I got 2 8 balls of dope in my pocket. I'm high. I've been high for days. I go to church because I went to church. You didn't ask the last time I went to church. You just asked, you go to church. They didn't, but I'm, you know, hear me this morning. All they did is ask me if I went to church. They asked me, you know, and I told them yes. They didn't ask me if I, you know, about Jesus. You know, I didn't know about Jesus. And this is what that man told me. He, instead of telling me about Teen Challenge, he told me about Jesus. And he said, Dusty, the reason you're empty, the reason you're hopeless, the reason you're broken, the reason you're constantly going back every time you get out of jail to the drugs is because you don't have Jesus. You don't know Jesus. And I'm like, well, tell me about Jesus. At this point, I'm like, I'll try anything because I've tried a lot of stuff and it ain't been working. Right? I mean, y'all tried some stuff, a couple, two or three things. I could tell you lots and lots of stories about all this, but I accepted Jesus into my life November of 2002. I was arrested October the 3rd, 2002. It was a month later, I accepted Jesus. And I'm telling you, when I put my hand, like he said, you know, put your hand up against I was in my visitation booth. So I put my hand up and he led me to Jesus and I prayed. And I literally, he said, some people feel stuff, some people don't. And I'm not a feeler, but I literally felt something come off of me. And it was from that day forward, I'm telling you, I didn't cuss again. I stopped using drugs when they'd offered it to me, and it wasn't easy, but I started praying, and I started asking God. I prayed this simple prayer, could you touch the judge's heart, could you touch the prosecutor's heart, and make a way for me to go to Teen Challenge? And I prayed that so legalistically, because I thought if I didn't pray it, that God would not answer, you know, he just wouldn't do it. And as I prayed that prayer faithfully every night, I was sentenced to 10 years, so I'm a convicted felon. I hope that's okay for you, that your pastor's a convicted felon. But Moses probably would have been a convicted felon too, and Paul probably could have been in that, you know. So there's a few of your Bible writers that could go there. But when I got to Teen Challenge, see, a problem of a lot of us that go to Teen Challenge is that we see Teen Challenge as our punishment and not our provision. So we see it as our punishment and not our provision, because whereas presence is, there is provision is. And so we're legalistically going through a program, missing out on the provision that's right there. And what we do is we squander the promise. We squander the provision because we're so caught up seeing it as a punishment, right? The Israelites, when they were delivered miraculously out of Egypt, when they were out there and they started seeing all this stuff, all they did is murmur and complain, and they didn't realize that where his presence was, his provision was there, and they were living even in the wilderness. They had it all right there if they would have just said. And when it hit me one day, Colossians 1:16 and 17, you know, I just started memorizing scripture, and y'all know I memorize a lot of scripture because I just throw it out all the time. And so if you memorize some scriptures, don't stop there. If they make you memorize 3, memorize 5. I'm telling you, you're going to need it. Just take my word on it. You're going to need it. It said, for by him all things are created that are in heaven and that are on earth, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created, catch it, through him and for him. And when it hit me that all things were created through him, I was created for God, to have a relationship with God. You mean, wow. You mean the creator of everything that I see and I don't see wants to have a relationship with, I was created for him and not just me for me? Right? Because I heard it. I mean, I was at Teen Challenge for 3.5 years. I was a special child, so I needed a little extra help. No, I worked on staff for 2.5 years. But my point was, so many people that come through Teen Challenge, they saw it as a punishment. They couldn't wait to get out so they could get on with their life. And I'll tell you, everyone that said that ain't doing it. They weren't doing it. Everyone that just couldn't wait to get out because they got to get back to their life. They didn't have a life when they got in there. They ain't going to have a life when they get out of there. If they don't get that, they got a life now. You ain't got to wait to get out. You got a life. You got a life now. Not just them. You got a life now. You can have it now. The power of God is in your life now. If you'll accept it, embrace it, and walk in it. But listen, listen, listen. I want you to hear this. Listen where the shift was in the text. This is a shift. It was a shift in my life. It can be a shift in your life this morning. You can go and never be the same. I promise you. But then I recall all that you've done, O Lord. I remember your wonderful deeds, O Lord. Long ago, they are constantly in my thoughts. I can't stop thinking about your mighty works. He chose to shift. Instead of focusing on his circumstances, he focused on who God was. They testify this morning. I'm testifying who God is, what God has done. Some of you parents are going to take what I've told you that God has done, and you can hold on to it, because if God did it for me, God can do it for you. God will do it for you. Oh God, he said, your ways are holy. Is there any God as mighty as you? You are the God of great wonders. You demonstrate your awesome power among the nations. By your strong arm, you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. See, get this. Too often, the church, you hear me say this, y'all are praying for God to take you out of what God's going to bring you through. God, get me out of this. God, take it away. God, I told you, God ain't afraid of your pain. God ain't afraid of your fear, right? And I'm going to tell you, I told the church this, he ain't afraid to use what you dislike to get what he dislikes out of you. Come on. God's either working something into you or he's working it out of you. And if you all admit, he's got a lot to work out. Right? That's why he'll use those things you dislike to get what he dislikes out of you. Because it takes the you not liking it to get to a place to where you'll cry out all night long. And so when we start to see this, that God will bring us through. She quoted Isaiah 43 to you. But now, you know, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, fear not, for I've redeemed you. I've called you by. When you walk through the waters, he didn't say, I'm just going to take you out of it. He said, when you walk through the waters and the rivers, they shall not overflow you, and the fire, they shall not scorch you, right? Because he is the Lord our God, the Holy One of Israel. God's wanting to bring some people through this morning. Some of you have been praying. You've been praying, and God's wanting to bring you through, right? Because, listen, listen, it's when he brings us through, you got to learn to embrace the process. In the process is the progress, and in the process is the testimony, right? When you embrace the process, God's going to reveal himself. The magnitude of the revelation will absolutely blow your mind when you start to just hunker down and trust God through it and embrace the process. They wanted, the Israelites wanted out of it. They just, take me back. I'll go back to my mess. Instead of embracing the process, right? And this is where it takes them. When the Red Sea saw you, listen, here they are, the Israelites. They've just left Egypt. Miraculous. They saw miracles unparalleled in history. And here they are now with their backs against the Red Sea, and they just think God can't do it again. Can't do it again. He's already done the most amazing things in front of those who thought they had the most amazing gods. And now their back is against the Red Sea. And what do? They go into their whole mess again. Oh, why did you lead us out to all this, that, and the other? Why'd you take me to Teen Challenge? It's hard. They tell me when to get up and when to go to bed. They tell me when to make my bed and how to make my bed, how to fold my clothes. And when they tell me all these things, I can only talk to them. I did all this, you know. All of this. Why do I got it? Why do I got it? Why? But listen, listen. It says, when the Red Sea saw you, O God, its waters looked and trembled. The sea quaked in its very depths. The clouds poured down rain. The thunder rumbled in the sky. Your arrows of lightning flashed. Your thunder roared from the whirlwind. The lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. But listen, listen. Your road led through the sea. Your pathway through the mighty waters. A pathway no one knew was there. You led your people along that road like a flock of sheep with Moses and Aaron. Another version says your footprints were in the sand and they didn't even see it. The people thought it was just them standing there. The waters didn't see the people. The waters saw God. God was right in the midst where his presence is. Come on, that's where his provision is. And if you'll just keep your eyes on Jesus, right, you're not going to have a problem when Brother Andy tells you to go do this or not do this. You won't have a problem. You just got your eyes on Jesus. And for everybody else, if you'll just keep your eyes on Jesus this morning, right? Even if your back is against the Red Sea and the army's coming to kill you, right? It will see that the presence of God is with you. Come on, I want you to hear this when you leave this morning. Where his presence is, there his provision is. Seek his presence. Seek his presence this morning because he'll never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. I want you to stand this morning. Some of you probably in here that you needed this word. And maybe some of you in here, your life is not in that place. It's not right with God. Karina's going to lead us in No Longer Slaves again. But we're just going to close it out that way. But if you need to come up to the altar, look, if you need some people to pray with you, Pastor Tom's going to be up here. Some of the prayer team members that want to come up here, if you need somebody to pray, maybe you got some loved ones that are battling addiction, maybe you're dealing with some issues, we're going to be up here to pray with you. We're going to pray through this because that's what God does. He prays us through. He brings us through. Amen. Maybe this morning your life, like I said, is not right with Jesus and you need to get it right. This is your moment. Ask Jesus to forgive you. Ask Jesus to come into you. This is that moment. This is that moment where we seal the deal. You don't want to walk out of here the same way you came in. You want to walk out of here in the presence, right? You need the presence. So seek the, maybe you just want to come kneel at the altar. Maybe you just want to come. But as we confess these words over our life this morning, you are no longer a slave to fear. You don't have to fear. You don't have to walk in that this morning. Amen. You're no longer a slave to sin. God has set us free from that. And he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Amen. So we'll sing and then I'll come and close us in a prayer in just a few minutes to seal it. It just takes a couple minutes in the presence of Jesus. It just takes a couple minutes in the presence of Jesus. Now, I'm not saying pray shallow prayers because sometimes you got to learn to tarry and press through. But I'm just saying, you've heard a lot this morning. Amen? So if you want to step out this morning and kneel at the altar, if you want to kneel at your seat, just do that this morning as Karina leads us in this morning.